Thank you. A big round of applause for Keepers of the Flame. Well, good evening, everyone. I'm Molly Giordano. I'm the Executive Director of the Delaware Art Museum, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to tonight's opening festivities for Afro-American Images 1971, The Vision of Percy Ricks. This exhibition has been in the works for many years, and first and foremost, I must thank Margaret Winslow, our Curator of Contemporary Art. I believe Margaret is back in the booth, but please, a big round of applause for Margaret Winslow. My portion for this evening is brief. I just want to thank our advisory committee members, our sponsors, and some of our elected officials and trustees before I introduce Margaret. So please, if I announce your name and you're an advisory committee member, please stand so we can honor you. We had many advisory committee members working over the past several years to guide this exhibition as well as its related programming. Ray Jones Avery, Harmon R. Carey, B.B. Coker, Colette Gator, Arnold S. Hurt, Dr. Julie McGee, Dr. Kelly Morgan, Dr. James E. Newton, Dr. Jean Nutter, Rita Vulcans, and Marilyn P. Whittington. If you could all please stand so we can appreciate you. Thank you for your hard work over the past 3 years making this exhibition come to life. This exhibition was organized by the Delaware Art Museum and Aesthetic Dynamics, Inc. It is made possible by the Johannes R. and Betty P. Cromer American Art Exhibition Fund and the Emily DuPont Exhibition Fund. This exhibition and its related programming are made possible through grants from the Jesse Ball DuPont Fund, PNC Arts Alive, DuPont, Corteva Agriscience, Bank of America Charitable Foundation, and the TD Charitable Foundation. It is sponsored by AARP and M&T Bank, and tonight's party is sponsored by Troutman Pepper. Additional support provided by the News Journal. This project is supported in part by the National Endowment for the Arts. This organization is supported, in part by the Delaware Division of the Arts, a state agency in partnership with the National Endowment for the Arts. The division promotes Delaware arts events at DelawareScene.com. As you can see from that lengthy list of sponsors, many, many people have been invested in the success of this exhibition. Last thing I want to do is acknowledge several proclamations which are outside the auditorium in the glass case. We have a proclamation from the Delaware House of Representatives, one from the City Council, which was sponsored by Council President Ernest Trippi Congo II and Council Member Brigetta A. Fields, and from the Office of the Mayor, proclaiming today as Percy Eugene Ricks Jr. Day. Yay. We also have some Delaware Art Museum trustees in the audience. If you are a trustee, could you please stand so we could recognize you as well? I know we have, okay, great. We have, thank you. Thank you, Ken, Susan, Elva, and Barack for being here this evening. And now it is my pleasure to introduce Margaret Winslow, our Curator of Contemporary Art.
Thank you so much, Molly. There are many signs and symbols that represent the circular nature of life and the benefits of reflection. But I was not familiar with the Sankofa bird until meeting Dr. James E. Newton and discussing the legacy of Percy Ricks. As Dr. Newton explains in his thorough review of Ricks's creative vision, the Ghanaian concept of Sankofa is essential for progress. We must revisit the past to imagine the future. Planning for Afro-American Images 1971, The Vision of Percy Ricks, began more than 5 years ago during the 2015 Delaware Art Museum exhibition Dream Streets, Art in Wilmington 1970 to 1990. In my research, I found the price list for Afro-American Images 1971 in our Helen Farr Sloan Library and Archives. Dr. Newton, as aesthetic dynamics historian, contributed to the Dream Streets catalog, and paintings by participating artists in 1971 were on view in the 2015 show. The conversations with Dr. Newton continued, and the idea of restaging Afro-American Images 1971 at its 50th anniversary in 2021 was conceived. I am so grateful that we are here this evening to celebrate. This project would not have been possible without the numerous individuals who have so generously provided their support and knowledge. We are grateful to the many private and institutional lenders that made this vibrant restaging possible. What a joy it was to trace the paths that these fine works of art made, from artist studio to the Wilmington Armory in 1971 to the collections in which they are held today. Numerous family members, art historians, artists, advocates, and community leaders kindly offered their contributions and memories to expand the story of Afro-American Images 1971, and each morsel of knowledge propelled our endeavors forward. We extend our sincere thanks to Simone Austin, Dr. Melanie C. Harvey, Ellington Lindsay, and Dr. James E. Newton, the contributing authors to the publication. And we appreciate the many community members who offered their insights on specific works of art in the exhibition. You'll find their contributions on the object labels in the gallery, as well as within the exhibition catalog. And last but certainly not least, we extend our utmost thanks to our partner, Aesthetic Dynamics Incorporated, who enthusiastically embarked on this journey with us. Leading the group are President Michelle Thompson, Vice President Organization Officer Arnold S. Hurt, Secretary Treasurer Rita Hurt Fulkins, and historian Dr. James E. Newton. We are thrilled to feature the artwork of Aesthetic Dynamics members Valerie Kennedy, Ben Pierce, and Carl Vincent Williams, who created the fabulous commemorative poster for this exhibition on view in the gallery, along with a special poem written by Aesthetic Dynamics former member, founding member, Lula Cooper. You'll also find that on view in the gallery. And we wish to acknowledge Simi Knox in particular. As an original Aesthetic Dynamics member, an invaluable friend of Percy Eugene Ricks. It is my honor and pleasure to introduce Dr. James E. Newton. With detailed notes and a remarkable memory, Dr. Newton captured the wisdom and legacy of Percy Eugene Ricks and has generously shared it through his spoken and written words. An artist in his own right and a published scholar, Dr. Newton has made invaluable contributions to the fields of art, history, and art history. He holds a Master of Fine Arts degree from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, a doctorate in curriculum development from Illinois State University, and is Emeritus Professor of Africana Studies at the University of Delaware, where he directed what was then the Black American Studies Department for over two decades. Dr. Newton is an invaluable member of the social and cultural fabric of Delaware. Having served on numerous nonprofit boards, including here at the Delaware Art Museum, lending his expertise and perfect balance of wit and creativity to this community's endeavors. I am personally and professionally grateful for the knowledge and friendship that Dr. Newton has had on my curatorial practice. Dr. Newton.
Thank the Delaware Art Museum, Margaret Winslow, for inviting me here to speak on my mentor for 40 years, Percy Eugene Ricks. Ricks not only was my mentor, he was a confidant and friend. I met him in 1968 through my wife, LaVonda, for 54 years. She was a teacher at the Byard Middle School, and Percy Ricks was an art instructor. And she forced me to go to an open house. And there I was able to meet, not did I know then, that Percy Ricks, and he began to inform me and philosophize about art. And at that time, I didn't know he was going to be my mentor, but ultimately, that's what he became. And from that time on, he visited me as Black Studies Director every month at the University of Delaware, and he usually brought intriguing people with him. I was one of these people who took notes on everything. Everything that Rick said, I noted it. He quoted, he philosophized, he mused, he did all those things, and I was the recipient of it all. I would not be standing here today if I did not have the professional mentoring of one Percy Eugene Ricks. Before I begin, I'd like to give you a sample of Percy Ricks's philosophy. As African Americans, we must have a reverence as well as knowledge of our history and heritage if we are to restore our future. The study of the past is a prime necessity. History must restore what slavery took away. Percy Eugene Ricks, 1923 to 2008. That's the kind of musing that Percy Ricks would add to any young man looking down the road to a career or a profession in art. He was especially gifted when it came to looking at the world, not necessarily always in rosy colors. He was candid, frank, and direct about his sayings, and he did not bite his tongue. I always considered him not only to be frank, candid, and direct, but he pulled no punches, and he had equal opportunity for criticism to everybody. Let me take a minute to get some things together here. I want to do a brief biographical sketch on Mr. Ricks. Many of us have heard of Ricks, might have heard of him, but many of us don't know his particular background. 13 years and 5 days ago to the date today, the Delaware art community and the community at large lost one of its most dedicated and devoted members, Percy Eugene Ricks, Jr., the first son of Mr. and Mrs. Percy Ricks, Sr. of Washington, D.C. He was educated in the segregated District of Columbia schools. He came out of the highly touted Armstrong High School in 1939. The people who went to Armstrong High School, its rival school, Dunbar High School of Washington, D.C., tout some of the most famous African Americans of the 20th century. Alongside of some of those schools, when we compare, it was Booker T. Washington in Tulsa, Oklahoma, Hillside High School in Durham, North Carolina, Dunbar High School in Baltimore, Maryland, and several others. And none but not least, among the highly touted segregated high schools in the nation was Howard High School of Wilmington, Delaware. Ricks came out of that era. Most of the most touted people in the 20th century African Americans ended up in Washington, D.C. Ricks grew up there. His family and people loved music. They loved art. Percy Eugene Ricks entered Howard University at the age of 16. He was a freshman at the age of 16. He became a ROTC cadet. The ROTC cadet, the Reserve Officer Training Corps, he stayed in from 1939 to 1943. After Ricks had graduated, he ended up, at first when he went to Howard University, he come under the tutelage of James Amos Porter. James Porter was the early professor, and one of the early professors in art at Howard University. He went on to became quite famous, primarily because he wrote the Modern Negro Art book in 1943, I believe it was, and he became known as the father of African American art history. He was a painter in his own right. If you look here in the left, Porter on the left, 1957, that painting, self-portrait of him, is in the National Gallery of Art. And to the right, you have young Percy Ricks. At the time, he was probably 19 or 20 in the 1940s. He graduated in 43. He probably painted this in his early years. Most artists do self-portraits, etc. Ricks did the young self-portrait in his 40s. In the 1940s, while he was a student at Howard University. And his mentor there on the left, James Amos Porter. Okay. Ricks went on after he left the military. Ricks served in the military from the duration of the war. And following the war, Ricks went on to Columbia University in New York, where he received his master's in art education. After he left there, he became the first African-American art teacher in the segregated Wilmington schools in 1947. And here we see Percy Ricks working with young students at the Frederick Douglass Elementary School. And there is Ricks, an art instructor, helping the young people learn their crafts in art. In 1947, as I said, Ricks, for several years, taught at various schools, P.S. DuPont, Byard Middle School, and other places. He was serious about his artwork, and he believed that, from what I looked at upon his philosophy, he believed that art could be used as a tool for communication. You didn't have to become an artist, you didn't have to like artists, but art, but you could communicate through art. And that became his kind of comments. We can communicate through the arts. At Stubbs Elementary, Frederick Douglass Stubbs was a thoracic surgeon, and that's where that school was named after. His father, J. Bacon Stubbs, was one of the first surgeons in the state of Delaware, especially in Wilmington, Delaware. He came from a famous family of heart surgeons and so on. So he was at the Frederick Douglass Stubbs Elementary, and then he moved on to P.S. DuPont, an experimental high school that began to take in black students. One of the foremost writers on human relations was Muriel Crosby, who was a human relations specialist, an English specialist really, but she got into human relations, started to begin to integrate the schools in Delaware, the major high schools, Wilmington High School, P.S. DuPont, and the segregated Howard High School. Many teachers came to the P.S. DuPont High School, and this is where Ricks from the mid-60s on to the 70s, Ricks began to crystallize his philosophy about art and art education and young people communicating through the arts. In the middle of 1960s and 70s, Ricks began to consult for the old Swedes church, and began to move the old Swedes church from the recreational kind of orientation to an artistic thrust. And he became the catalyst for the development of the Christina Culture Art Center. And I was his assistant, or his boy Friday, constantly watching everything he did and picking up some of his attitude. The imagery in black was a program that Ricks developed. Christina was looked upon as a visual and performing arts center. And many of the shows there were done by local dancers, local artists. They performed plays. David Gray performed plays, The Raisin in the Sun by Lorraine Hansberry. All these things was given the community an idea that the Christina Culture Arts Center would be a center for African-American arts. And Ricks was the interim program director. I was his assistant, and we consistently attempted to program young people to come to the shows, especially the children would be bused in, and they had the several community centers. West Side, they had People's Settlement, they had Christina, etc. And the children sometimes would be bused in to begin to make use of the arts. Imagery in Black was one of Rick's first shows with the Christina Community Art Show. The art center, I mean. When we look at the Ricks thing of the 1971 Ricks show, we'll notice that. Somebody come and take care of that. Let me give you a little more background on Ricks while I get straight. Percy Ricks, the Wilmington News Journal wrote a statement about Percy Ricks when he passed away. Percy E. Ricks, Jr., 85, artist, educator, and administrator in Wilmington, Delaware, a loving father, grandfather, and uncle, died of complications of a stroke on October 19th, 2008, at St. Francis Hospital in Wilmington, Delaware. As a respected artist, Ricks, as he was lovingly called by his friends, had been the recipient of many honors. His works have been exhibited throughout the United States. After he retired from the public schools, he became an active public servant and advocate for the arts through the new organization, Aesthetic Dynamics. He was the catalyst in the art in the development of the artistic thrust of the Christina Culture Arts Center. Mr. Ricks was survived by his wife, Celestine, four daughters, Andre, Nicole, Michelle, and Danielle. A brother, Dr. George Ricks, an anthropologist and ethnomusicologist, two grandchildren, two nieces, and one grandniece. Ricks had, despite all the activities in his life, was a person who did not move from any ideas. In 1971, under the umbrella of the aesthetic dynamics, Ricks, who he claims he got this idea from the civic shows in Philadelphia on African-American art, and established the Afro-American Images 1971, which included about 65 or more artists. And the artists were like a who's who in African-American art. Ricks knew personally Romare Bearden. He told me, I called him Romare Bearden. He said, Newton, is Romare Bearden. Romare Bearden, Romare, quote, Bearden, did not want to be called Romare. He wanted to be called Romare Bearden. Ricks was a close friend of him and his wife while he was a student there at Columbia University. He knew James Porters, he knew Hal Woodruff, Margaret Burroughs out in Chicago. He had a range of artists that he touched base with. The result, the 1971 show. And this show, when we take a look at it, it was a show of people who were already, quote, household names when it comes to African-American art. There were emergents, there were would-bes, upstarts, and all kinds of people who ended up years later becoming quite well known as from the result of this particular show by Percy Eugene Ricks and the Aesthetic Dynamics. The Aesthetic Dynamics started out with 8 members. None of them were necessarily professionals in the art museums. Most of them were educators and teachers. Columbia University had placed into Ricks's head that educators can do a lot to aid and assist children, and art can be a vehicle that could be used as communication through the arts. Ricks was a firm believer in that, and for many years he taught in the junior high school level. The Alma Thomases, well-known artist from, sought her training right here at People's Settlement in Wilmington, Delaware. She was the first graduate of the art department at Howard University. She consistently wrote Ricks when she had shows, and she stayed at the same junior high school that she taught from early beginnings. Ricks himself also was very clear about sticking with the elementary and junior high schools in his art teaching. It's like a who's who of African-American art, 1971. Most art historians and stuff looked over this event, but Ricks had put on what we consider to be a blockbuster of a show. And some of the names you see are household names. Can't hear. Okay. Get to the next. One of the things that we find after the can we get to that one? This is one of the articles written by Ruth Kaplan. Kaplan was a liaison for Aesthetic Dynamics. When this show came about, the left picture you see, Robert Moore, he was an art instructor at Wilmington High School, but he was at one time a superintendent of art at the Wilmington schools. On the right, you have the venerable Ed Loper, the icon of African-American artists here in Wilmington, Delaware, who went on to give one of the biggest shows at the Delaware Art Museum, his retrospective. Okay. Here on the left, we see C. Douglas Buck's wife, Polly Buck. He was a governor and senator of Delaware, and she was the one from the agency, the Delaware State Fine Arts Council, that gave the $10,000 to do the Afro-American Images 1971 1971. On the right, you see Norman Lewis, New York artist, with his famous painting Processional, which is on view in the show here that's been restaged. Here you have flashy Percy Ricks. And believe it or not, the Howard University group came here in good numbers. On the left, you have Mrs. Porter. James Porter died 1 year before this show took place. His widow on the left is, that's Mrs. Porter. Lila Pierce, also from the Washington, D.C. area. For years, Percy Ricks had worked with the District of Columbia Art Association. They gave several shows, and they were quite supportive of African-American artists up throughout the Eastern Seaboard. Here you may not see the individual there, but Gertrude Jenkins was one of the original members of the Aesthetic Dynamics group, a teacher at P.S. DuPont. She taught physical education, but she was also, she's on the left, actively involved with what was going on at the Christina Culture Arts Center. Girls dancing in dance courses and things like that. Quite a colorful career. In messages from some of the former students, they say she was a real advocate for African-American students at P.S. DuPont High School when they integrated. Gertrude Jenkins, one of the colorful figures of aesthetic dynamics and an advocate for young people. And here you have the contingent of Howard. You have Lomaeus Jones, a famous artist and a teacher of Ricks at Howard University. The Delaware Museum has a recent purchase of one of her pieces. Next to her is Dr. Albert Carter, who graduated from Howard 1 year before Ricks, and Lila Pierce, another DC artist, all there looking at one of their own, Percy Ricks. Interestingly enough, one of the original members to the right, Simi Knox. Knox was one of the hard workers trying to put this aesthetic dynamic show together, working tirelessly and making sure that everything was done right. And he ended up as one of the foremost international portrait painters during the time that he and I were studio partners on Market Street. He did not paint portraits. He primarily painted abstract, huge abstract paintings, of one of which is in the show, the early show in 1971. Ricks was a hard person to catch up with. Once he had that success with the 1971, he did several things. In 1976, the bicentennial came around. He got another grant to do Black Kaleidoscope, Black Sound, Black American Image. Al Cato and other musicians, Arnold Hurt and others, became partners and members of Aesthetic Dynamics. Ricks did that show in 1968. He did another one in 1981 where his focus was on African-American artists from Delaware. To the right, and at the Delaware Historical Society hosted that show. And his most ambitious show was Freedom 2000, Affirmation and Expressions. It was not approved by the Delaware Waterfront Commission or group, but he had 14 galleries that he had looked at after the Nicholas and the Russian Tsar show came. He thought that that should be, another show should be done relative to that, so he chose Delaware, the state that started the nation, Freedom 2000, Affirmation and Expressions, dealing with 14 galleries of works by international African-American artists. etc. And the 14 galleries would deal with the theme of freedom. He chose Delaware in the first two galleries because Delaware, the first state that started the nation. Ricks did not let any grass grow under his feet. He was constantly involved with new projects. I couldn't keep up with him. He had so many projects in the making. But his last show, the Freedom 2000, probably would have been the biggest show that ever happened in African-American art in the nation. And he thought that he was going to be able to get it at the riverfront. A 72-page booklet was made and presented to the authorities, but it was rejected. Any questions from the audience?
We welcome. Is that on? No.
Yes.
We welcome any questions from the audience.
Those other exhibitions from Freedom 2000, the first two were held in Delaware. Where were the rest, my understanding? But there were other exhibitions outside of Delaware?
Yes. A group down in Maryland, the Smith and Mason Gallery, had an exhibition a few months later in 1971 and with several artists. As a matter of fact, Percy Ricks was on the advisory committee for that show. But it appears that the Afro-American Images covering five states, New York, Pennsylvania, Maryland, Delaware, and the District of Columbia, he seemed to have had such a network in all these areas that he was able to bring forth several artists because of his local connections. Percy Ricks was a good communicator, and he kept in touch with these various artists, and all people had to do was say they have a show, and Ricks is it, people would automatically stop everything and make sure that they supported the show by Ricks. But the Smith-Mason Gallery also had a show at 1971. One of the big things was that in 1970, the closing of the National African American Art Show in Atlanta, Georgia had closed. So this was an opportune time. At one point, some people believed that because the Atlanta show was in Atlanta, most of the artists there tended to come from the southern states. Ricks, having been a native of Washington, D.C., was certainly concerned about assuring that artists in this area would get their due. And he was also in the show. He had an art piece in that show at the Smith-Mason Gallery in 1971.
Any other questions from the audience?
Can you speak to what, to your knowledge, what kept artists continuing to make art despite the rejections that they were getting?
Oh, well, being an artist myself, I can tell you why. We were smitten by art. Just because we weren't getting the attention and all that doesn't mean that we weren't going to stop art. I started dealing with art as a third grade teacher, thought I was daydreaming, decided that maybe I can be the school cartoonist. And lo and behold, I became the school cartoonist. I didn't know what cartoonist meant, but I was smitten by drawing things on the wall, over here, over there. And the artist is like it's almost like an outsider. For some reason, they have art in their veins and they intend to be creative regardless of what anyone else thought. Of course, your mother or somebody's gonna get tired of you scrolling on the walls, but that is also something inside the artist as of the musician. One might decide that it's in their blood. but at some point in time in more recent times, Ricks was even thought of going so far as to create an African, not an African-American, a universal federation of artists, so that, like musicians, they get paid for doing things. But the artists, despite the things that occur, having to cart things to museums, not getting recognition and appreciation, the artist seems compelled to assure that his voice be heard. This is why we're kind of reminiscing somewhat on Percy Ricks. Regardless of the fact that he had talent and ability and could have went to higher grounds relative to the art world, but he fought the good fight to assure that people begin to take a look at art as being something of value to themselves and their communities. So many artists do it because of compassion and for other reasons, but if the artist does not view it necessarily as money. One of Ricks's comments was that an artist may not get the attention from public view. And sometimes, in some ways, the artist is in a lose-win situation. However, some, when they die, are worth a pot of gold, but while they're living, they're not worth a wooden nickel. So this is what we have. The artist is in pursuit of some kind of communication through art. He's just using art as a vehicle for communication.
Yes.
Any other questions?
Yeah, Jim. Ricks was so profound in his philosophy and his writings, and I'm wondering if he put anything together in a booklet form, in a book, or if he did not, is that something that could be done or is in the works?
As I sit here today, I can say that the story of Percy Ricks is still unfolding. There's information that he left. He left me a couple of boxes of things 3 months before his death, and I'm not a young whippersnapper, as he would call me years ago, anymore. So we try to piece some things together. If you get the catalog that the Delaware Art Museum has, we have a good first step in trying to put together some aspects of the life and times of Percy Ricks. I call it his journey, a man who wore many hats, and Ricks wore a lot of different hats. And we would hope that some of you who may have known Percy Ricks could come forth and provide interviews or something so that we can get some of what you think, how you perceive Percy Ricks, because we know that Ricks gave his all for his students, and at some point we have to give our all for him. Another comment I'd like to make is that Ricks had a group of people who he worked with. He had people who were co-chairs, Baltimore Shock, Robert Moore, those kinds of people who were community advisors, Lulu Cooper and people like that. She was with the YWCA. He had a host of people, a team that worked to make this Afro-American Images come forth. And I feel that not having a commanding person like a Ricks is critical today. He actually took the bull by the horn and did something about it for this community, the Wilmington community, the Ben Pierces. We know who we are. Those who were under Ricks, understanding the dynamics and the need for art, we owe it to ourselves and Percy Eugene Ricks to maintain what is taking place now as a tribute to Brother Ricks, that we will carry this thing forth as best we can.
We'll have one last question.
I have more of a statement. I was a student at P.S. DuPont High School, so I was an art student of Mr. Ricks. And he was obviously a very personal, private man because I knew he was an excellent art teacher, but had no idea that he was fully involved in all the other things.
That's an interesting comment because Ricks was a humble person in his own right. He was very candid and he let people know. I've seen him say, yes, but thanks, but no thank you, several times to people. If he didn't like where they were coming from. And you know how difficult that can be, don't you? When you say things that people don't like, there are consequences. And many a door was closed in Rick's face. I was there, I saw him. And he seemed to not let that stop him. And Ricks was an interesting person in that he did not let what you thought get to him. He knew what he was thinking. And I found that very interesting in a personality type. I come from a family of 9. I had 4 sisters. That's enough. You don't have nothing to say. You got 4 sisters, you'll know what I'm talking about. And you got to remember, Ricks had 4 daughters. Yeah, I had 3 daughters. See? And so Ricks was, he appeared to be thin-skinned, but he was a tough cookie. Let nobody fool you. He was tougher than what he appeared to be. As a matter of fact, I'm a person, blunt, I could ask you a question. I asked Ricks a question. In short, it's not only none of your business, it's off limits. There's some things that I could not talk to him about. Primarily because he knew what he wanted me to know and he knew what he didn't want me to know. So I don't pry like that. But I have to admit that Ricks was a selfless, non-self-serving individual. And in this me world, you understand what I mean. I also would make a comment about the Delaware Art Museum. We know the Delaware Art Museum, it was in 1970-something, we were still almost in an apartheid world. Agencies and others who had no intent of being prejudiced or anything were caught up with the system. Many have relented against it. Some have not. See? The Delaware Art Museum has taken a big step for what Ricks called a reflection, recognition, and reconciliation is what we're looking for. See, Ricks was blunt about it. We want respect. We want recognition as artists. And we want appreciation. That's all the artist is asking. That's all the artist is asking. So the Delaware Art Museum, curator Margaret Winslow, and others have done a tremendous job of assisting us in letting you who hadn't seen Afro-American Images 1971 and 71, 50 years later. This is the anniversary of this show. Yeah. 50 years, and they have in the past 6 to 7 years decided to put it together and let this institution become not just the Delaware Art Museum, but a museum for the community. You see, you got to understand, when you share, there's lots of things. Another thing I'd like to mention, a thing from Percy Ricks. I did something one time, and Ricks said, Newton, stay in your own lane. He said, the musicians take care of the music. You heard them, weren't they good? Yeah. See? He said, the artists take care of the artist. The historian takes care of the historian. The art historian takes care of the art historian. Stay in your own lane. He said, the reason for that is when you bring them all to the table, they all have something to share. If you start sharing what they're going to share, they don't give a chance to share. This is the kind of philosophy and attitude that Percy Ricks taught me. And I had to learn the hard way because I was an ambitious young whippersnapper, as he said, who thought that this is the only way to go. Helping others and sharing is what Percy Eugene Ricks taught me. That it wasn't about me, it was about sharing with others, whether you like them or not. He was quite profound. You can do that. We're now going to take a look at, what is it? You know, when you think about it, amen. Did you know that during the colonial period here in the state of Delaware, they had laws. The laws suggested that if African Americans or slaves at the time gathered in appreciable places, it could only be for the purpose of worship. Therefore, the congressional record will tell you that Delaware is the cradle of black religious freedom. See, you hear that? And that such glorious characters as Richard Allen of the African Methodist Episcopal Church. You know all about Richard Allen. Yeah, you can't leave Delaware without hearing about old boy Rallin. What won't happen? You heard about Peter Spencer, the UAME church. Don't get into the church thing. You'll be talking alphabets all day. And you won't understand them. The AUMPUAME. It's the religious orientation. And then you had some of you may not have heard of him, Samuel Cornish. From Kent County. Cornish was a pioneer in the founding of black Presbyterianism right here in the state of Delaware, the cradle of black religious freedom. And then you can't get around the Delaware Art Museum without Absalom Jones, the first black ordained minister in America, affiliated with St. Thomas Episcopal Church in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. The cradle of black religious freedom. Can I get an amen from the brothers and sisters? See, that's what the amen thing is about. You got to be able to do an amen. Spirit is in this building right now. Think about it. Perfect spirit is with us today. Did I hear an amen? All right, African-American Images. 1971. We're talking 50-year anniversary. 50th year anniversary. And here I am with my chest floated out. My mentor, 40 years, Percy Eugene Ricks. You don't know what that means to a young brother like me. I'm old now, got gray hair. But a young brother back then, with a person in front of him, you couldn't beat me. You couldn't beat me. We have that mentorship in it. Porter. Rick was a house. He was in the house of the porter. She's a well-known researcher. The pioneer and developer of the modern system of archivism. The archivist and the librarian. Rick is killed. The widower of Jennifer Porter. Gratitude for her international development of the order has been going down as one of the most useful archives on African American research libraries. Mrs. Porter.
Okay.
One of the things that's most unique about Percy Ricks, that's his iconic image, Guardians of the Image Makers. Guardians of the Image Makers. Percy Ricks. I've seen that image for years and found that Ricks is, it's obvious that at delicate, intriguing, design by a master craftsman. At the same time, it's a revealing image of the guardian of the image makers, Percy Eugene Ricks. Ricks went on, I have tried to make an interpretation of this piece, and it dawned on me that Ricks himself is one of the guardians of the image maker, especially the image maker of the African American in the state of Delaware. Artists can also look at Ricks as the guardian protector, the big brother, the one guardian of the image makers who transpires into himself. Ricks was the guardian, the big brother of us all, African American artists in general, and more specifically for African American artists in the state of Delaware. Percy Eugene Ricks.
And we welcome you all up into the galleries. They're open, galleries 9 and 10. Music has started. Thank you so much for joining us in celebration. Thank you, Dr. Newton.
Thank you.
I didn't know what that was here. But because the way I was there. Huh? I think it went okay.
No. It's been great.
You got they're playing music down at the
they're playing up
and upstairs.
Antonio?
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, okay. They up there now?
They've been.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Oh, that's okay.
I hope I didn't go over time.
You'll get all that. He had a folder, I think.
Yep.
It's right in that here. Right here. Put it in there.
I think probably 70.
Oh, okay.
Maybe probably more, actually. I think
are they letting them in the gallery now?
They are. Oh, okay. Yep.